and for working with me this semester. We've had such a wonderful experience together. And what I want to say by way of introduction is that Sarah came to me, she approached me in the winter through John. John was our contact. And thank you, John. And Sarah, in her final semester, really wanted to explore her love of poetry in a personal way, not through critical analysis, but in a way that really would help her find language to connect her journey to meaning through her love of poetry, and vice versa. So we met about that, and that's exactly what she's done. She's created a really beautiful meditation on this link between language and literary text and personal meaning. So I've been really thrilled to work with her. And I was going to begin the lead into the question of what matters to you by actually reading something, a quote that you included in your text. And this is a quote by Roca. Read as little as possible of literary criticism. Such things are either partisan opinions, which have become petrified and meaningless, hardened and empty of life, or else they are just clever word games, in which one view wins today and tomorrow the opposite view. Works of art are an infinite solitude. Only love can touch and hold them and be fair to them. So I want to begin there, because Sarah speaks a lot about connection and love in terms of what matters to her. So to turn it over to you and what matters to you.
Thank you, Melissa, and thank you all so much for being here. I'm just overwhelmed by all of the faces that I see. It just means so much to me to be able to share this space with so many people who are so dear to me. And when I was thinking about this question, I've had the whole year to meditate on the topic that I would for my discussion, and I settled on the theme of connection. And I find that connection comes up to me in four important ways. The first is the connection that I share with my friends and my family and the people I love the most, because I feel that the people in my life are the central part of my life, and they inform who I am on a daily basis and also the way I perceive of the work that I do, and I hold them in my heart when I act in the world. The second way is the interconnectedness of humankind. I fundamentally believe that all of us are connected, and I think that comes up in a number of ways in life, but you know, we share the same earth, we share the same resources, the same history. And I think that really matters. And knowing, you know, coming from that belief of interconnectedness and interrelatedness, I've come to conceive of the work around social responsibility as being a fundamental part of who I am. I can work from that place. And the third way is a little more conceptual. There's this quote that I really love by this Zen master that says, the nature of enlightenment is to be intimate with all things. And I like meditating on this idea of the intimacy with life, because I feel that it's a gentler way to approach daily interaction and also a gentler way of seeing the world. I think that our culture is one often of disconnection and distraction. We connect with the internet more than we connect with each other. And I think that can be a really problematic way of interacting, or like way of relating to the world. And I think that that sometimes leads a lot of people to push things away, whether it's pushing away empathy or responsibility. But that intimacy is kind of a call to see things very clearly and act with compassion. So if we can be intimate with the life that is in front of us, whether it's the space that we're in or the relationships that we have with one another, or you know, thinking about human suffering in an intimate way, that can inspire us to act more gently and compassionately in the world. And then the fourth point of connection that is and has become even more important to me over time is the connections that one can make between seemingly disparate things. Intellectually, what I really enjoy and am most passionate about is making intellectual connections between things that don't seem like they would be related, but can actually be related. One way that this has come up for me most recently and acutely with my project with Melissa has been to relate my study of literature to the wider world and to my personal development. And I think that's, for me, that was a really important place to reflect on my education as an English major. When I decided to be an English major my sophomore year, I said to my advisor that I wanted to study the human experience, and I felt that literature was the best way to examine human life. And I think that's definitely been true. You know, reading texts or poetry has allowed me to examine, you know, friendship and love and suffering and war and dying and politics. But I, you know, that's taken, you know, I've had to take time to think about how those things can be related to the wider world and to acting with social responsibility as well. And the other way that I find I feel called to connect spirituality and politics as well. You know, I find that I am a person with a spiritual practice, as I'm uncovering more and more. And I find that if we are able to apply transcendent truth to political spheres, I think that really great work can be done from that place. And there's a quote by Oliver Wendell Holmes that I really love. And he says, you know, I would not give a fig for the simplicity on this side of complexity, but I would give my life for the simplicity on the far side of complexity. And what I like about that is, you know, I think we all can relate to the fact that we're inundated with these images of chaos and violence every day. You know, if you open a news website or, you know, you walk through the dining hall, these are things that we have to cope with. And our world seems gripped very much by complex frameworks that can be very useful in reading the world, but I think that the true work lies on the other side of that, which is finding meaning from those paradigms or frameworks or trends, and being able to take that truth, which is, you know, for me, and love and compassion and ideas that I hold dear to dear, and taking that and
something that's very beautiful. I want to say first, you see why I love working with Sarah. We have these really little light conversations when we go together. But something that has come through in your writing and our discussions, and you know, Sarah kind of framed the work we did in part as looking contemplatively at poetry. But really what you've been doing is looking contemplatively at yourself in relationship to poetry. But one of the things we've talked a lot about and a struggle you have, which we all share, is how you integrate the fact of suffering into the notion of doing good and being a change maker and going out into the world with a sense of hope. And that's been a big part of your question, I think.
Yeah, I've definitely been thinking about the question of suffering, particularly this year, but over the course of my time at Middlebury. A huge part of my experience here, besides the fellowship, was my work with the organization MidSafe, which is the peer support system for victims and survivors of sexual violence. And I chose to step back from that work this year because I needed some space from the intensity of the suffering that I was on this campus. And I think that we all, in our different ways, you know, in our own lives, we experience difficulty, but I think we also, I know intimately from being on this campus that all of us encounter instances of suffering here. And I think that, you know, part of empathy is connecting to the parts of ourselves that understand pain and know pain intimately, and being able to relate to the other person in front of us who's struggling, whether or not that circumstance is the same. So in a way, seeing suffering and wanting to act requires us to know suffering in our own way. But at the same time, I think that, you know, a lot of our culture now makes a spectacle of suffering. If we look at I'm fascinated by the way that, you know, we consume media as well, like the 24-hour news cycle that seems to fixate on really graphic images of violence or really graphic reports of violence, and I've felt very affected by those things as well. So it's, at times it can feel like, you know, I'm coping with suffering in front of me, you know, in my daily life, and then you look and see that just reflected on a really large scale. And that can feel very disempowering, I think. And so I think that, you know, the danger in that is that, you know, we're inundated with these images, and we can become fatigued by that. Like the idea of compassion fatigue, I think, is very real. But I think the work is to be able to find ways of restoring ourselves, and also being able to sit with both joy and suffering. Because I think the deeper we can know, you know, joy, you know, the deeper we can know suffering, the more attuned we are, the more sensitive we are to life around us. It means that we'll both we'll experience both profound suffering and profound joy. But I think that just requires an openness and not being afraid to be open with both.
Can you say anything about what you've discovered in your last few years here? And Sarah's also studied at Oxford for part of the summer, mm-hmm. and spent time in New York City. So through all these different parts of your journey, what you found helps you kind of move through that suffering and relook at yourself in a way that allows you to act?
Yeah, I think that the kind of where I found myself geographically, I've realized has become very important to my narrative of my time at Middlebury, as we've kind of explored in the independent study. But I think that the danger in any space, whether it's like being in New York City where everything moves incredibly fast, and when I was there, I noticed that people seemed to become very desensitized to the people around them because it requires so much mental exertion just to get from one place to another, you know, and yeah, there's so many people around all the time. And then at Oxford, you know, driving up to Oxford was a very different experience than I imagined, because it's a beautiful town. It's like, it just evokes so many things when you drive up, but also all of this knowledge that is very powerful is kind of kept behind these very thick stone walls. So it's kind of this metaphorical opposite, in the way that New York City is kind of like bursting with intensity, and then Oxford is like, everything is very contained. And so I think there's danger in both, like becoming desensitized to the intensity of things because it's difficult, and then also becoming desensitized because we're escaping from the reality of the world that we live in. So I think that, you know, Middlebury has felt at times like that as well, you know, that we're situated in rural Vermont, and it can feel very much like an incubator. And I know we've talked to a few of you about that over the years, and feeling frustrated with being in a space that feels so isolated and so much in a bubble. But I think a lot of that work is personal as well, as it, you know, or what are we aware of, and how are we taking that awareness forward, because different places would present different challenges, I think, around those questions.
Do you have practices that help you in different locations stay kind of emotionally on task?
Yeah. It's not easy, definitely. I think for me, I found that writing is a very powerful tool for that. One of the things that I've liked so much about the fellowship as well is that, you know, every summer we write a report, and for different fellows that takes a different, it manifests itself differently depending on what the fellow, how the fellow feels like they can express themselves. And so for me, I've always written like a narrative piece, because that's helped me reflect on the place that I was in and who I was when I was there, and how am I bringing that back to Middlebury. So I think that's been the thing that's been most consistent. And, you know, it's hard to keep track of how we're growing and be present at the same time. So writing has helped me too.
So I have a question about the work you did in New York.
Yeah.
And maybe you can explain it a little bit, but also when I first asked you what matters to you, you said connection. So I'm curious if you can talk a little bit about that sense of connection through some of that, your experiences doing some of this work, the kinds of work you've done around writing and whatever other aspects you think are important, and kind of what you've learned from that about connection.
Yeah, definitely. Last summer was very powerful in the work that I did through an organization called Partnership with Children. And what I love about the work that they do is they place social workers and counselors in schools that are disadvantaged economically. And so they tend to pull from demographics of students who are exposed to a lot of trauma. And what the work I was doing for the organization was researching trauma-informed school paradigms. And it has this very kind of, it's like the name itself sounds very esoteric, but it's actually a very simple practice. The data that the trauma-informed schools collect is essentially around how they approach students. So normally, the traditional paradigm, which I think came out of the No Child Left Behind policy, is to approach a student and with no excuses. So you know, if you misbehave, you're punished for it, which I think is just hugely problematic in a number of ways. But Partnership with Children works to approach children, with a more gentler and a more holistic lens. And so trauma-informed paradigms stipulate that if you go to a student and you ask them what's coming up for you, as opposed to why are you, what are you doing, that improves their education outcomes like tenfold, and it also decreases expulsions and suspensions. And obviously, someone who does that work could explain it more eloquently, but what I took from that was that it was a very simple solution. You know, we tend to, get bogged down in thinking about education reform, for instance, as a very tangled bureaucratic endeavor, but actually what this research was saying, what I took from it, is that if you approach the individual student with compassion and love and empathy, that student does better, So to me, that's an example of the simplicity on the far side of complexity, is that, we can get tangled in thinking about, what does it cost to reform schools, but, the cheaper and simpler and more beautiful option is to approach the student as a human being. And I just loved that, because I think that's incredibly powerful, and that's what people deserve.
Somebody we're working on at Middlebury, too.
Yeah.
right. Especially seeing who you talk to.
Yeah.
So this leads me to another thought, which has to do with some of the things we've talked about. You Sarah mentioned to me she's the only CSE fellow who's in the humanities.
Right? In my cohort.
In your cohort.
Yeah.
And we've spoken a lot about connection and even love and spirituality in terms of finding meaning and direction. And we kind of touched on the notion that for CSE fellows, that could be maybe foreign territory or maybe language that's not very familiar, kind of maybe pushing the boundaries a bit. But to you, it's very central in terms of how you think about your role in the world.
I think I've been so inspired by the people that I've met, particularly my cohort, just over time. And I'm so inspired by the work that they do, but I've also felt like the way I've always come to the work has been through the humanities lens, and that's something I've shared with people before, but it feels very central to the way that I relate to the world and the way that I think about questions of social responsibility. And I think that, poetry is often seen as an escape from reality, whereas, in the work that we've done together, I felt that by looking closer at these poems that are considered, romantic poetry, thought of as escapist poetry, these poets are actually really grappling with difficult questions about, who we are and, questions of human suffering. One particular poem that's become very central to my experience as a student has been Wordsworth's Tintern Abbey. And I actually wrote my college essay on Tintern Abbey and then returned to Tintern when I was in England this past summer. And he talks about the still, sad music of humanity, which I think is a beautiful line. And I think it shows that, you know, these literary figures were grappling with the world that they were a part of, which was chaotic and disappointing and also, you know, upsetting, you know, to a sensitive soul. And I think Wordsworth in that poem talks about the need to restore oneself, either through returning to a place or through connecting with, you know, for him, his sister. And reading those words has really helped me think about being a sensitive soul in the world and wanting to act and wanting to sit with the sadness in life, but also knowing that that weighs on me. And for me, that these poems have become even more central to that inquiry.
And we've also touched in our conversations on linking the kind of spirit in poetry with the notion of compassionate action, mm-hmm. right? And yeah. kind of the ethic to care.
Yes.
That's prevalent in more traditional Buddhist scripture or mm-hmm. texts, things like that.
Right.
And how that links really effectively and powerfully with social action and
yes.
social change. And that notion that you have to do the inner work in order to serve and to do the outer work. Of that, and without doing the one, the suffering can become overwhelming.
Yes.
Yeah. Would you? I was wondering if you'd read the Middlebury poem that you start your
yes.
meditation with.
I will. Yeah.
just to bring in some poetry.
Yeah, absolutely. So that this is the poem that kind of serves as the introduction to the work that I'm working on now, which is a longer narrative piece, but it's called The Peace of Wild Things. He says, "When despair for the world grows in me, and I wake in the night at the least sound, in fear of what my lives and my children's lives may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water, and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things, who do not tax their lives with the forethought of grief. I come into the presence of still water, and I feel above me the day-blind stars waiting for their light. For a time, I rest in the grace of the world and am free." I've always loved this poem because I think, you know, the act of waking in the middle of the night with anxiety is something that I think everyone can relate to. And what he talks about coming into stillness within himself and finding this freedom that comes from stillness of grief and anxiety, from grief and anxiety, is a really beautiful and comforting thing to
do. Just one other thing we've talked about, the way silence lives in every poem
mm-hmm.
and how silence, again, in order to be a change agent, to be effective in the world, you have to be comfortable with your own silence.
Yes.
So sitting with the silence in a poem and finding what its place is to hold, to keep the whole together.
Yes.
And the same with your own imagery. And I want to add too, this make, the silence makes me mm-hmm. think too. You haven't mentioned yoga.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Can you say something about your yoga?
Sure. So I became a yoga teacher over the past few months. And
on top of everything.
Yeah. And, you know, it's something I've thought a lot about, kind of this, the practice of yoga and the practice of mindfulness, you know, is something that is being commercialized, definitely. But for me, the practice of that movement and stillness, or preparing the body for stillness, has been very powerful, and I am an anxious person, as most of you know, and that is a way that I learned how to breathe and sit with life, you know, and move through difficulty in the body, and then, you know, I think that's a reflection of the way that I'm experiencing the world, too. So for me, I think that's been really powerful over time.
Is this the time to open it up to questions?
Yeah.
Great. Does anyone have any questions for Sarah?
Hey Sarah, so thanks for sharing. You said something really beautiful in the beginning when you said something about to learn the depth of joy or the depth of suffering kind of complements one another.
Yeah.
And yesterday I had the opportunity to meet with Julia Alvarez. I don't know if you've read any of her work.
Yeah.
She talked about reading and writing and how it's a way to, she said something like, stretch your muscles of compassion. And I'm wondering if you could speak to your academic involvement and kind of how literature has allowed you to kind of understand the depth of certain feelings or certain emotions, and do you find yourself struggling with that at times? Like, what is that relationship like?
Yeah, thank you. That's such a beautiful question. I definitely agree with what she says. I think that for me, I've seen the study of literature as a way to cultivate greater empathy, because reading a text, and obviously I think texts are different, like they have different agendas. So, you know, my thesis is on female embodiment in Victorian literature, which is very academic and theoretical, and I love that exploration. But I think the act of reading, and, you know, as Morsa quoted, you know, Rilke saying that, you know, to be able to hold texts and love them, I think is a practice in a way of like being able to adopt the world of another. And I think that functions on the level of the text, like moving into the world of the text, but also the author and kind of adopting this lens or this framework that the author presents. And I think, you know, David White, a poet that I really like, he writes beautifully on vulnerability and courage and various topics. He says, poetry is the language for which we have no defenses. And I like that idea because if we can meet the text where it is and be open to that, that, you know, then I think that is a defenseless space. And I think that our culture could use more of that, of shedding our defensiveness and meeting people or meeting experiences with more openness.
Thanks for sharing. So, you obviously read a lot. And I was wondering if you had like three things that you think we should all read. Sarah's required reads.
Oh my gosh. Oh, it's so hard.
Or three things you really like.
Yeah.
Okay.
How's that?
Yeah, I think, oh gosh, there's so many things I would recommend in various categories. I think the poem Tintern Abbey is very central to who I am, so I recommend anyone read that. It's a beautiful meditation on change and relating wisdom to people we love and finding refuge and all of these really wonderful ideas that I think particularly people, I think any age, but you know, for you know, our time in life, like I think that's a really beautiful thing to read and learn from. I feel like I'm gonna forget things and be upset when I recently read Between the World and Me by Ta-Nehisi Coates, and I love Ta-Nehisi Coates' work. It's just so profound. And I think he explores some of the same ideas with a totally different framework, and I think that is really valid as well. And I would, Letters to a Young Poet is a really wonderful book by Rilke, and it was something I read 2 weeks before coming to college and just reread for my project with Melissa, and he gives a lot of advice on life that I think is valid and at least got me to think about how I would conceive of some of the things that he said. So, there are some.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Set it out
to us.
Yeah.
Sarah's blog.
Yeah.
opens up to connection, and the more you aspire it, desire it, sometimes you open yourselves to vulnerability.
Yes.
Because when it's not reciprocated, it can be really helpful.
Yes.
I wonder how you deal with that, and how you have like an empowering idea to, you know, just the act of loving others, trying to be connected, empowering yourself and identity is really important.
I think that's something that I struggle with too, because vulnerability I think is very difficult, because it's scarier, and it is this openness that is, you know, not necessarily reflected in a lot of spaces in our culture. I think it can be painful to be vulnerable, but I also think the world needs more of it. So, I mean, I obviously, you know, have had times when I like don't feel very vulnerable and have closed myself off. But I think for me, particularly the notion of being intimate with whatever comes up, like the intimacy with life, is something I return to because it does help me feel more empowered thinking about those things. So, part of the work of being intimate with life is, you know, when joy comes up, we can be intimate with it and sit with it. But it also means that when painful things come up, we also have to be intimate with the pain. Mm-hmm. And that's hard, but I think that for me is like what I think about. Like, how can I sit here and be intimate with what is in front of me? Mm-hmm. And I think that that's a really freeing idea, because it means that we're seeing things with clarity, you know, like we're not pushing it away, kind of like turning away from experience, but it's hard. I totally agree with you.
Thank you so much for sharing today. It's been really wonderful to hear your thoughts. And I'm just kind of thinking on the intersection of your work with NSAVE and your studying of trauma and how people process trauma, and then obviously your immense wealth of knowledge on literature and expression and storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm curious, sometimes, I don't know, maybe this is just personal, but I feel like this happens with a lot of people where it doesn't feel like there are words to process or to express what has happened. And I was recently reading an author, Lisa Valenzuela, who talks a lot about writing from the body.
Yes.
As kind of a response to that, of just not having words or not feeling like a language can actually encompass what has happened.
Yes.
I was curious if you could just kind of speak to that, like when when there aren't words, what's next?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, totally agree with that. I'm not like a very verbal person, so like, I'm not skilled in like a lot of other areas of discussion. But I think that's why it's like art is really beautiful. Like Rilke talks about like art as a way of, you know, it's just another way of living. And I think for other people, like they can capture things that I can never, I mean like so many things I could never capture, and so many things that all of these authors that I read all the time can't capture. And I think about, like there's this quote in Eliot's Four Quartets that talks about history is a string of timeless moments or something like that. And the image that I get from that is that there are these moments that we all experience, mostly probably by ourselves, you know, things that we witness, like whether it's, you know, the mountains at sunset or, you know, the acts of compassion we witness or something, that we just kind of are, just witness those things. And, you know, whether it's dance or music, I think those are all components of life that are consoling, you know. And I don't think you really can put everything into words. Like, I remember this one professor was talking about this passage in a Shakespeare play about how, you know, when you say something is like something else, it's saying that it is like that, but it's also not like that. So it is that thing, but it's also not that thing. And I think that's kind of what language does to a certain extent, is that it tries to get itself around these parts of life that it probably never can. And I think particularly with pain, like people kind of try to grasp it, and sometimes it is like a really arresting image, and sometimes it doesn't quite get there, you know. And I totally feel that as well.
We've also talked about the way in which language and poetry, you feel it evokes a state of connection, both with what the image is and the feeling state that's going to be shared or suggested in the poem.
Yeah.
And so it's not necessarily the explicit language. It's the feeling and the sense of understanding or recognition that goes with it. So how you find meaning in these places of connecting with vulnerability or sensibility, you know, kind of goes underneath the language.
Mm-hmm.
And there's the stillness, which I see so much in Sarah. Sarah accesses this these understandings and wisdom through this great stillness.
So if you look at your time at Middlebury and your experiences of it at a personal level, what would you say you're taking forward as you take the next step from that?
Yeah, it's definitely the past few months have been like thinking a lot about that and feeling like I haven't quite figured that out yet. I think
I wasn't thinking career.
No.
There's, I haven't asked anything about.
Yeah.
It.
I think what I'll remember most from Middlebury are the people that I've met here, which wasn't always, you know, so much of Middlebury has been very busy, and I think, you know, it's taken me until my senior year to really crystallize that, like, the people that I have loved and cared for here are the people that I'm carrying with me, and, you know, it's been ultimately a composite of the experiences that I've shared with, like, so many people in this room and the conversations we've had, and, you know, the work that I've done in the classroom, like, you know, I was... The job search has been difficult, definitely, at times, and I, you know, questioned whether studying English was a good foundation. But then I really came back to this place, particularly over this past semester, of just being incredibly grateful for having read a lot and learned a lot and been with really great people. And, you know, it's just such a finite period of time. And for me, you know, college is, you know, coming to an end. So. Has been the people, I think.
I just wanted to maybe make an observation and then turn the tables a little bit. Hearing you today, in a beautiful way for me as one of the founders and the director of the center, shows in kind of full bloom what we've tried to do. So some of you know that we had a donor come along in this November of 2010, thanks to Aaron here, and who said, you know, we'd love to have a Center for Social Entrepreneurship here. And I'm sure that donor's vision was students busily starting social enterprises and, you know, doing balance sheets. And I think that might have been sort of our vision initially. And we've come so far away from that. And you represent sort of the apogee of that. The hype of that idea, I'm not an English major, beautifully. And what you said about connecting, what you said about love. When I go around talking about this stuff, I often say the world really doesn't need another 1,000 people trying to change the world, but we do need a few more people who are doing that hard work of knowing themselves and then connecting. And so I just want to say in all sincerity that you in so many ways, along with your fellow fellows this year, the capture of what we've tried to do, and beautifully. And so thank you for that. Just awesome. And then this is the first of these Reflection Fridays where the parents have been. So we would be remiss not to give the parents some kind of opportunity, at the very least to respond to our gratitude for bringing Sarah into our community. But I wondered if you had some reflections and thoughts about...
If you have questions.
Yeah, or questions.
They probably shoot us. Questions, but.
I just wanted to be a quiet observer today.
Well, I think we never get an opportunity to see Sarah, so, and obviously this is, we're just kind of joking when we're walking in. I think the last time we attended one of her events was when she was in fourth grade. And ever since that, she said, you know, that Maybe you guys should not come. Maybe you're embarrassed that he wasn't. I think for us, you know, we're very blessed to have, you know, Sarah. She's our oldest, and our youngest is a freshman. So, you know, to see the progression, just seemed only yesterday that we dropped her off in the middle of frigid conditions in February. And to see, I mean, we've always known that she's very compassionate. You know, her gift is she has a big heart. And I think it shows, you know, how she kind of reaches out to the world.
Very true. I've learned a lot about the two of you this year.
So, Sarah, I have a question for you. It's sort of an absurd question, but my 12-year-old the other day was telling me three things that scare her. And one of them was silence. Mm. And I'm just curious if you have any advice.
That's interesting. I think silence becomes less scary the more we have to sit with it, you know. And I think, particularly being at Middlebury, just thinking about these 4 years, like, I was very scared of slowing down at the beginning. But I think life just, like, requires us, like, there's just so many instances where we have to be with ourselves. And I am an introvert, so I tend to be, I need space to myself. But I think sitting with silence is something that I've just practiced over time. And, I think that life kind of pushes us into those moments, even when we don't realize it. Like, you know, sometimes when we need silence the most, it's the most chaotic, but then that moment arrives. And do you have any?
Well, we've talked about silence kind of as a relationship with our thoughts, right? not just our inner emotional state, but
right.
How we respond to our thoughts. And these practices we've talked about with mindfulness meditation, where you more and more watch your thoughts instead of simply letting them take over. Mm-hmm. And even with a 12-year-old with a very busy mind, those kinds of practices, I think, are very helpful to become more and more comfortable mm-hmm. with slowing down that reactivity, mm-hmm. to whether it's, you know, whether you get angry or even really reactive in a positive way, you know, just understanding that it's your mind, it's not who you are, it's your mm-hmm. thoughts, you know, that kind of understanding. Mm-hmm. It helps. I think it's interesting because she's growing up in Vermont, which is a very quiet place. She doesn't even know.
Yes, I mean, you obviously love English and literature and poetry and things like that. And I come from Afghanistan, which is a big with Persian literature and Pashto
right.
literature.
Yeah.
And so I learned English as a first language. I had to learn later on. But then one of our philosophers says that a language is a growing body. It
yeah.
actually grows.
Yeah.
It grows with us
yeah.
as time changes and things like that. But he says, he warns in one of his poems saying that when we grow, we don't lose our body parts.
Mm.
But when language grows, sometimes some languages lose their body parts.
Mm-hmm.
The reason I'm saying is that when you come from outside to the US, mm-hmm. you find out that English here is very different than the English that you learn
mm-hmm.
in a non-English speaking country.
Right.
So I come here and, for example, we used to say, look it up, now we say, Google it. Or I had a professor in college saying that whenever he was coming to the class, he was saying that, turn off all your eyes, iPhone, iPad, and things like that. So, I mean, technology is obviously having a lot of impact, like selfie, for example.
Right.
Selfie is a new creation in terms of its
mm-hmm.
words and stuff
yeah.
like that. So,
mm-hmm.
should we be warned, should we be worried about how the effects of our advance as human beings, should be worried that we are losing the origins of a language, should we be not, should we be happy about it? Is there work be done to preserve things or not?
Yeah.
It's a big question.
Well, I think
what I've learned, you know, as an English major, just like how much the body of English literature has changed so much over time. So, you know, if you go back to reading Chaucer, like Chaucer's language is like so fundamentally different than contemporary poetry. So I think in a way, like, language is always changing. I think for me, like, we were just talking about this, about contemporary poetry and why people tend to criticize contemporary poetry, because it tends to be more surface level than poetry of past decades and centuries. I think for me, like, poetry has become an antidote to our changing world. So thinking about technology and its kind of grips on our culture, and how that is changing our language and the way that we connect and relate to each other, that for me, poetry is a really important step back from that. So I think that would be my answer to it, just like returning David White's words about poetry is the language for which we have no defenses, is an important thing to hold on to as our culture changes. And I think reading, like the act of reading, is really important as well. Because if you read, like, I think a broad enough body of literature, you have a bigger kind of reference of literature and the fullness of language, and that, you know, language can become fuller over time, but that we don't have to lose it. Because I think that's the danger in contemporary society too, is we try to become more efficient and more streamlined, that, you know, language shouldn't necessarily take the same path. And, you know, poetry is efficient in one way, but in with a really intentional purpose.
Amazing, as per usual. And I was wondering, we've spoken a lot about mindfulness over the past few years here together, and I think that it's one of those narratives that is interwoven throughout the fabric of Middlebury, and one I think that needs to be emphasized now more than at any other time. And obviously, you spent so much time meditating on what that term means, mm-hmm. and how it can be affirmed on our campus. How do you think that mindfulness can be incorporated into our campus at a time when open dialogue is being fostered more at any time than ever?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I was actually just at a conference on mindfulness last week, and what I found was really striking is, you know, there were, you know, 2 full days of just talk after talk about mindfulness. So it was like by the end of the weekend, like, I was kind of saturated because I didn't know what mindfulness meant anymore, because it had just been talked about so much. But I think after taking some space from it, you know, mindfulness is, I think, above all else, intentional awareness, you know, with non-judgment. And I think that that's what's important to bring to Middlebury, like, as a principle, is a greater, like just more awareness about the self and about the community, and also less judgment. Because I think, you know, everyone at Middlebury is a high-achieving, hard-working person for the most part, from what I've encountered. And there is a lot of room for improvement and growth, I guess, as far as, like, you were speaking about, like, the need for more inclusive dialogues and talking about mental health and race on this campus and inclusivity. But I think a mindful way to approach those conversations is with that intention of awareness with non-judgment. And I think that's where the power of it comes in. Like, I used to be really interested in how the brain changes when we meditate, which I think is still really interesting, but I think what's even more powerful than that is, you know, who are we when we're less judgmental of ourselves, but also of other people.
Did you happen to hang out with Lori Benn?
No, we have to take a walk from McCullough to Mead Chapel, unfortunately, because her office hours ran over. haven't seen her since, but I've always been really moved by particularly what she says about the poet in society.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know, I don't know that studying English will be in my future again. That's something I'm thinking a lot about now, but the notion of poetry's role in a good society as a principle, I think, is really interesting. Mm.
I think we should bring all the powers that we have under the CSE umbrella to get you two together.
Okay.
Not just shaking our hand in the
right.
Seriously, yeah. I think we really should.
Okay.
I think our time is almost up. Do we have any other last comments or questions? I'll end with three lines from a poet who I love, and reading this morning reminded me of Sarah's quest for meaning and how she finds it in poetry, in mindfulness, in her life. And this is a very simple thing he wrote. His name is Stanley Kunitz. And he wrote, "I never tire of bird song and sky and weather. I want to write poems that are natural, luminous, deep, and spare. I dream of an art so transparent that you can look through and see the world." So, thank you so much.
Thank you.